two centuries of Christianity. And the church that is misreading, and a person must not mutilate himself or herself. In short, notice, very early on, that was taken by, actually, he became a heretic. That's another reason that he's not a saint. According to the church, he misunderstood and took that literally and mutilated himself. And so that is, the church forbids self-mutilation.
But that's kind of hard to understand, to say that the Bible is infallible, yet we don't take it literally. It sounds like two sides of the same thing.
Thank you. I appreciate that statement. The church, and this is in the Catholic Catechism, said to take the Bible literally without recognizing context, audience, type of literature that it is to misread the Bible. And there is no equivalent in there. That's the closest you can come, that action, self-mutilation. That's about the closest you can come to anything that's contemporary that we call literal. Literal does, well, St. Paul said, the letter kills, the literal kills.
The so letter kills. We are not asked to be fundamentalists then. We should, then can we bring that to our daily life too? Like, we have this huge discussion about the Constitution, about whether we should, you know, be an originalist or, so do you think that's something that we are asked to do as well, Deacon?
Yes, it is. And so across the board, the church says literal readings lead us into error.
Is it, I'm guessing maybe not on big issues, but or very substantial parts of the Bible, but even Catholic theologians, some that are conservative and some that are more liberal, couldn't they look at the same passage and come up with different interpretations?
Absolutely.
So how does that fit with it being infallible?
Okay. I'm reading a book right now by Bishop Barron, and I forgot the major part of the title, but the subtitle is Catholicism, Both and. In other words, if you take one perspective without recognizing the complexity and the breadth of something, whether it's you're liberal or conservative, that's misreading.
And that's, I think that's, that points to the fact that as human beings, all we can try to do is educate ourselves and be open. But, you know, there are probably people even in our church that would look at us, you know, a certain, if they come at it from a very conservative standpoint, they may or may not be willing to step outside of, you know, their comfort zone, just kind of like we have in our political. You know, it's sometimes it's really hard to cross that boundary and say, oh, I see some positive in this and I see some positive in that. And I guess that's the challenge.
That's the challenge. And I would say, well said, because this is one of the, let me go back to Vatican II. Vatican II said, in effect, to all of us, grow up. The church acknowledged that the church itself had treated Catholics like children who had to be told everything to do. And it said, no, your conscience has to take priority, and so you've got to inform your conscience, grow up.
See, that's why I think probably before Vatican II, we weren't taught much about our conscience, because the church wanted us to fall in line.
That's right, and the church at Vatican II acknowledged that.
Who decides when a Vatican II or a Vatican III is needed? What decides that?
The Pope. I think for about 400 years or more, maybe 600 years, there was no ecumenical council. By the way, the word ecumenical means of the whole church. In a sense, the whole world.
It's the difference between little c and capital C. And we can't look at just one source to form our conscience. We can't look at EWTN or Catholic Radio. We have to look at American Magazine and a variety of sources to inform ourselves and help to develop a conscience that that looks at social justice.
Absolutely. This is the reason the Bible. Am I responding to your question?
Yes, thank you.
That's the reason. In this regard, the Bible is infallible. It is very important, shall I say, to learn how to read well. If you're going to read the Bible and act upon it, it's very important to learn how to read well. And it is common statement among educators that we are not being taught to read well. Interesting that Harry Speck, some of you remember him well. Harry Speck was a chemist at Iowa State, and he worked on the
Manhattan Project.
I'm completely out of my head, thank you. He worked on the Manhattan Project, in fact. After he died, Edna, his wife, said, "Do you know he carried uranium from here to Chicago in his pocket?" And she said, "I washed that clothing and ironed it. And no telling what we were exposed to." But the reason I mentioned him, he came to my freshman English class, he asked to come, and he said, "You young people had better learn what Dr. McCulley's teaching you. If you don't, I can put band-aids on you when you become a graduate student and I'm directing you. But he said, you'll never amount to anything." He said, "You need to learn to read and write well." By the way, he did both.
Again, I hear what you're saying, and I'm not trying to beat a dead horse, but who defines what's well? And I guess what you said before is the both and.
Yeah, I would like to respond to who defines it. Okay, who defines what's a medical procedure?
The doctor.
The doctors, do they all agree?
No.
Nevertheless, they're the ones who define what's good medical practice, right? Okay, educators decide what is good reading or poor. Do they all agree? Of course not. They're still the ones who define what that is. And that was a chemistry professor who helped to define what good reading is.
And so the magisterium helps define what is good theology for us.
Exactly. But, again, we must conscientiously follow that, not just, well, that's what the church says, I guess that's what I have to do, and just disregard any attempt to understand that. Do you remember what he said?
I have one thing. I'm struggling with this because what I think I heard you say is if you are in doubt about something and you go ahead and do it, that is, that's sin. Mm-hmm. But here's where I struggle with that is that you can have people that sort of blindly read what they want to read and, you know, have their own conscience, and they say, I don't have any doubt, I'm just going to do this because I believe it's right. They're following their conscience, but their conscience might be leading them in a direction where you have somebody else on the other side and they're following their conscience real strongly, but, you know, again, I don't want to bring up politics, but you might have a Republican that's following his or her conscience, a Democrat following his or her conscience, and as long as they don't have any doubt, either by saying, I'm not going to even look at the other side because I just believe this is right, and so I'm not going to, and then you have the person that says, I want to be informed, so I'm going to try to look at both sides of the equation.
I would say not just both, but multiple sides.
Multiple sides. But somebody that takes that route oftentimes will probably have doubts because they're open to the fact that there's maybe more than one way to look at it. And it's a matter of, you know, what do I do with all this information? Whereas if you're just looking at it from one perspective, you don't have doubt. So you're not sinning by doing what
you're... Yes, you are sinning.
Even if you don't have doubt.
If you act... Okay. Now let me back up and respond to Sharon's double jeopardy. Okay, I like to use this analogy, and I used it years ago with the confirmands. I said, did any of you ever have a mother who said, don't go out without your coat, you'll catch a cold? Most of them said yes, and I said, did you go out without your coat? Almost everybody said yes. I said, did you catch a cold?
No.
Some said yes, some said no. I said, okay, Mother Church teaches us the best she knows. And if we choose to act on something other than that, we are acting on our own responsibility, and that may be sin.
Even though there's not doubt.
Yes. So it's double jeopardy. in the sense that, again, what is the church saying? Grow up. Inform yourselves. You're intelligent people. Then choose what seems to you to be the dominant or most important aspect of that. And I would say this, our moral theologian for the Archdiocese of Dubuque wrote as a moral statement for the Archdiocese, and I am so grateful he personally taught my deacon class, my class of deacons. And one of the things he emphasizes both in his writing and in teaching us, we live in a world of gray. Mm-hmm. There is no black and white.
Exactly. Yeah.
And therefore, he makes it all the more important to make a judgment like this, what's better and what's worse. That's what we're acting on, not what's absolute or absolute.
Christ is being crucified, he's up on the cross dying, people killed. And Christ says, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing.
Exactly.
So that almost touches on...
Of course it does.
These people are convinced they're doing the right thing. I mean, that's a hideous sin what they're committing, but in their mind, they were sin-free.
That's right.
So,
this is the reason the church has certainly subsequent to Vatican, after Vatican II, The church has emphasized mercy, forgiveness.
When I became Catholic, like 50 years ago, convert, there was always a lot of people at confession. Now, nowadays, you can't drag them in. Is that because people are telling themselves
there are many reasons for that. And actually, I was reading something that the Pope had to say about that recently. But because there's so many reasons, I don't feel competent to respond to that except to say there is a change in the culture. But as the Pope said, that's not the only reason. We are not well taught generally. And there are just many reasons for that.
Maybe the Holy Spirit is working this. It's a good thing. Maybe we're developing the way we're supposed to.
I don't know. I don't know how to make that judgment. I really, really don't. The only thing I can say is I'm responsible for me, not for everybody else.
Are there some that would fit within the perspective that you think, the both and perspective, that might still say that because the church teaches that that's an important part, you know, of our faith, that it could be sin not to go to confession? Or is that kind of a reach?
No. If I am convinced that the church says go to confession once a week and I don't do it, then that's sin.
Does the church say that?
Not that explicit. Church doesn't get that explicit. I remember I was talking with somebody who works with natural family planning. And he was making a statement that I did not agree with, didn't think was correct. And so I asked a pastor whose judgment and knowledge I respected. He said, the church is not going to get into anything that specific. So he said, the church deals with principles, not specific acts. In this place, and in this time, by this person, under these circumstances, the church cannot get into that. That's where our conscience comes in.
The world population is exploding. Is the church growing according to the way it's exploding, or is it going the opposite way?
Yes.
So, like, on outward appearance, we look like we're growing, but in the big picture, we're not.
The greatest growth in the church is Africa and Asia. The greatest falling off loss for the church is Europe. And now the United States is beginning to have slightly more losses than gains.
We're getting too intellectual then. We're getting too smart then.
No, we're not smart enough. Right. Yeah. Not smart enough.
Well, that coincides with what you're saying. We're informing ourselves, but we're misinforming
We're misinforming ourselves, yeah. Because we're not taught well, and we have no great concern to find out what is what to be well taught in general. Okay, I didn't finish this. Most of what the church teaches is called ordinary, fallible. What does fallible mean?
It's a faulty, can be mistaken.
Fallible is subject to error, infallible, not subject to error. So ordinary, infallible, that's the Bible and the ecumenical councils, not the regional councils, but the ecumenical councils. That's the ordinary, infallible teaching. Extraordinary, infallible teaching, there are only two in all of history. One was 1950, and the other was 19...
1800, wasn't it?
No, 1950, the
assumption.
That, those two, the assumption and
the Immaculate Conception.
The Immaculate Conception first, and then the assumption. And 1950 was the earliest one, the Immaculate Conception. And I'm losing, I can't pull up the date, it was after that. So there are only two of these. Most of the teachings of the church are ordinary fellow. And I've asked a number of, because of things that come up like this, I've asked a number of priests and a bishop, how do you know something's fallible or infallible? And the answer consistently is you don't. You don't until it's challenged. And if it's challenged, it seems important enough for the universal church to deal with, then it will be discerned.
Will that be challenged when they get to the pearly gates?
I suspect we'll all be challenged. If we say, I'm right, and I don't care, and that may be all of us.
Yeah, I certainly need longer purgation.
That's right. I like what he said, a longer purgation, more intense, or purgatory is in reality as opposed to in our perception. Yeah.
When you cited those two, is that related to when the Pope speaks ex, or however you say it, from the chair or something? And there's only been two of them in the whole history of the church?
That's right. Cathedra means chair. Ex from the chair. A teaching is not extraordinary infallible unless the Pope, I started saying in union with the bishops. I need to reverse that. The majority of the bishops in union with the Pope discern that. Notice I didn't say decide on that. I said discern that. And then the Pope makes the statement from the chair. Peter.
If a Pope makes a statement ex cathedra and it is considered to be extraordinary and infallible, is it possible for a later Pope to reverse that? Never.
Because it's infallible.
Even for later Popes and later councils and all of this.
Can you amend it?
Actually, I'm going to say yes to that, in that later popes have said that every part of the document on infallibility, it may not be complete. I mean, it may not be completely accurate. It's the teaching, not the explicit statement of it. This goes, one of my former students was interested in becoming Catholic. This, by the way, was before I was Catholic. He was in my medieval literature class. And so I sent him to St. Thomas, to a priest that I had gotten acquainted with and whose knowledge I respected. So he went over to talk with the priest. He came back and he said, why did you, that everything I asked him, he'd say, okay, he'd give me the teaching. Then Steve said, I'd say, okay, how am I to understand that and deal with it in my life? Why do you deal with it this way, understand it this way, understand this way? The ball van. And he said, everything I ask him, this is the kind of answer he gave me. I said, Steve, you want the answer to everything? He said, yes. I said, then you don't want to become Catholic. And so I hope this is helpful for us to look at all of this, because it's the kind of thing I don't see dealt with very much.
Can I ask, 2,000 years roughly, or if I've got my numbers right, that Catholicism, you know, has been in place? Is that right?
Well, I would say over 2,000 years.
So how is it that with all the popes that came before, there never was an ex cathedra teaching?
Well, there was. That has been there from Pope Leo the Great. That has been a teaching of the church. The difference is it was put into practice here, but had never been, there had never been a reason to make a statement before.
So, but none of those popes in the last 2,000 years, well, until 1950, ever said something ex cathedra?
Correct. And
but did that concept exist at those times?
It did.
John.
Wow.
It did.
That's amazing. That conception was infallible by under Pius the Ninth.
That statement was made, and interesting, that has to be so qualified that what it amounts to is what I said before. The bishops, majority of the bishops in union with the Pope and so on.
But
that idea was around again. almost nothing that can be said in the Catholic Church, and I guess I would say nothing that can be said in the Catholic Church today is new.
Those were traditions that the church had followed for years and years and years.
That's what I'm talking about. And then when they, starting as early as, in terms of, may have started earlier, but in 155, a man named Martian, a priest named Martian, some say he wasn't a priest, some say he was, but whatever the case, Martian said that that we Christians have to get rid of all this Jewish stuff and show it was anti-Semitic. And he said, so we are not going to read the Old Testament. It was not declared Old Testament in those days. We're not going to read those Jewish books. And he said, none of the material is to be, the only material that's to be read in the church is my edited version of Luke's gospel. Luke, remember, was the only Gentile writer in the Bible. And he thought Pope was as anti-Semitic, Paul was as anti-Semitic as he was. So he said, and the writings of Paul. And that's all that will be read in the church. Can you imagine what would happen if Father Jim said that? That's exactly what happened when Martian said it. Teachers and bishops began listing what should be read in the church.
And as a reaction to what he
as
said?
As a reaction to, okay. There was no Bible, and I'm moving to a handout I gave you. There was no Bible when Jesus was walking the countryside in Galilee and Judea. There was a sacred tradition, but there was not a book, not even a collection of books that everybody agreed on.
Scrolls.
There were scrolls, yes. And not everybody agreed on what was sacred tradition. It was very fluid. Okay. Christians began using a Greek version that was translated from the Hebrew around 250, plus or minus. And I think I've told you it's called a Septuagint, or the translation of the 70. of 72.
Again.
So Christians began using what was thought of as the Jewish writings to, quote, prove and teach Jesus. Okay? Make sense? Do you follow me? There was no New Testament, of course. They were using what we call Old Testament material, but it was more than Old Testament material. It was other books as well. And so, sometime between 90 and 100, and this is AD, this is BC, somewhere between 90 and 100 or thereabouts, the Jews declared their canon, that is, what was Bible for them, what was the sacred tradition for Jews. And notice, why did they do it? Because Christians were using their material to teach Jesus. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Well, it was broke, fix it. Again, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. It was broke.
Does that canon they came up with, 90 to 100, does that match what we have now in terms of the Old Testament?
No, that is the Protestant Old Testament, not the Catholic Old Testament. Okay. Because you see, the books that were in this and associated with Septuagint are different from the Hebrew. And so, what was used, and by the way, how do we know that? Remember, the New Testament was written in Greek. And the quotations that are in the New Testament from the sacred tradition are almost all from this translation. So from the beginning, that has been the sacred tradition for us Catholics, for Christians. Am I being clear enough here?
So that's why, like even today, like on an Old Testament in the Jewish thinking points to Christ, they go, that's pointing to something else. In other words, they're still sticking to rejecting Christ.
Sure. There's even a lot of other material along with that that supports their view. Okay, I gave you a handout today. I think some months ago, I told you that a book was published on, in effect, how the Bible came to be. And I was asked to prepare a study guide to be used in parishes. Well, I reviewed that book thoroughly and reread it. I gave it to a couple of people that had been in the Bible study. One was Alan Christie. And the two people I gave it to, who were more knowledgeable about the Bible, they both said, I can't read it. It's too technical. So I reread it and thought about what they had said, and I met with one of the editors and authors of that, because she's from Ames. And, she teaches at Indiana University, but she is from Ames. Her parents live here in Ames. So it was, in fact, I'm sure that's the reason I got asked to do it, because she knew me, you see. And so I gave critique, and I said, if you ever decide to revise that, I would love to be associated in any way possible, and I would be glad to give you feedback from the people that I know who are interested in the Bible. Well, she said that probably won't happen, but here is a review of that book. And what it is not really a review, It's a description of the book. And you see how the Bible became a book? It was not a book until probably not, certainly not before about 1300s. So it's on this basis that I have said to a couple of evangelicals who were so, who are a bit obnoxious, can I say? some people are very nice and some aren't so nice. I mean, polite, gracious. Anyway, I said to, I think it's two of them I said this to, you know? There was no Bible for hundreds of years, and even availability of individual books that people could read because most people didn't read. And the plan of salvation that you've just given me was not used at all until the 19th century. You know, it's absolutely amazing that anybody could be saved before evangelicals came up with that. That's not very nice. Made a call for me. But really, I think if that were known and understood, that would make a big difference. The plan of salvation, as evangelicals give it to us, if anybody was, well, it originated in the 19th century. It was put together then. And the Bible was not a book. Think about it. To try to have a book before the printing press, that's major work and major, I'll stop second, a long time.
So you mentioned that for right now for us, the majority of what the church teaches is, the Bible actually is ordinary, infallible.
Yes.
So Catholicism was in place, like you say, for hundreds of years. And so before there was this Bible, so obviously there were scrolls and that kind of thing, but what was the backbone of the Catholic faith before there was the Bible as we know it today?
The Bible.
In pieces.
The Bible in pieces, exactly. And the Old Testament. Okay, that's a good lead-in. Okay, I said we're going to talk about the Davidic covenant today, how it's fulfilled in the New Testament. Okay, you know most of this, I think. Remember, and what I'm going to say, Mike, and the basic teachings, notice the Catholic Church does not say the New Testament is, it says the Bible is infallible. Okay? Infallible in terms of teaching, morals and teachings, okay, beliefs. Remember in 2 Samuel, the 7th chapter, David wanted to build God a house. Do you remember this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and first Nathan the prophet said, go and do that. And that night, God spoke to him in a dream and said, no. And Chronicles tells us that the no was because David was a man of war. Okay, but David gathered the material for the house, even though he couldn't build it. Nathan said to him, God has said, I have been with you through the years, I made you safe from your enemies, and so on and so on. And I will raise up your heir after you from your loins. And I will make his kingdom firm. It is he who shall build a house for me. And I will make his royal throne firm forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. Okay. Now remember, in Old Testament tradition, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, how did a man, and this is male, this patriarchy, how did a man live on?
Through his son.
Sure.
Through a firstborn or only son. Okay? So, Solomon, and the word Solomon means peace. The words shalom, salem, all these are variants of the word peace. So Solomon built, excuse me, built a temple. But what did the Jews always say thereafter? I will read to you what they said, but I want to do it very quickly. The people of Judah and the people of Israel shall be gathered together, and they shall appoint for themselves one head, and they shall take possession of the land. And again, afterwards, the Israelites shall return and seek the Lord their God, and David their king. They shall come in awe to the Lord and to his goodness in the latter days. There are at least 6 books of the prophets that say that in many ways. You're familiar with Isaiah 11. A root shall grow from this from the stump of Jesse, and then you have do you remember what you have along with that? That's from Isaiah 11. A shoot shall come from the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding. Spirit of counsel, you know what I'm giving you?
Gifts of the Holy Spirit.
Pardon?
Gifts of the Holy Spirit.
Precisely.
What did you say?
Gifts to get the Holy Spirit. Those are the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Now that's in regard to, who is Jesse? Father David. So, the shoot shall come out of the temple of Jesse. And, okay, this, and any question about that? You see, they were looking for David. Okay, what was the tradition? According to Jewish tradition,
and that's part of preserving the Bible,
why was David so admired? Remember, he was an adulterer and a murderer. He was not admired for that, okay?
He was after God's own heart.
He was a man after God's own heart. An adulterer and a murderer is a man after God's own heart.
He repented.
And repented publicly. Okay. Notice, it isn't the sinless that is after God's own heart. It's those who repent of their sin. All right, in addition, what was the state of Israel during David's reign, according to tradition?
It was united.
It was united, good, yes.
Peace.
At peace, yes, good.
A land of milk and honey.
A land of milk and honey, abundance. And he maintained justice. Justice and peace go together. He maintained justice and peace. So the Jews were looking for the restoration of David. Okay, now, the people that the New Testament refers to, they were looking for what in David?
Second coming of David.
Well, in a sense, a second, that yes, they were looking for David, and their statement is they were looking for the Messiah. Or give me the Greek version of that word.
No, it did one.
That's English. Give me the Greek.
Christ.
Christ. Messiah, Hebrew, Christ, Greek, anointed, English. Okay, they were looking for the Messiah. Why? What's the connection of David and Messiah?
Because he come from the house of David.
He come from the house of David, but what's the connection with Messiah?
Savior?
He lead them out of...
Messiah doesn't mean Savior. Messiah means...
Right.
What does the word Messiah mean?
The chosen one?
No. Messiah, the word Messiah, anointed one. So, what's the connection of an anointed one and David?
David is anointed.
That's right, they're anointed king. And I would like you to turn with me to this. Turn to Psalm 2.
Messiah, Christ, and anointed. What are the different languages?
Messiah. I don't know what I do with it. And, but at the bullet point, it's gone. That makes sense. Thank you. I may have two up there. You know? Oh, yes, you may have two up there. okay. This is English, anointed one. Okay. Christ is Greek.
And that means the same thing.
All the same. Messiah. Oh, Christ and anointed one. So all kings. Some of you who are almost as old as I am remember the coronation of Queen Elizabeth. Do you know where they are anointed? I always thought this was interesting, to say the least. They're anointed on the head and on the breast. So, as I recall, the anointing on her breast was in private, which would make sense.
All of them, or just one?
Fred, I forgot to ask. yes, a king is an anointed one. So when the people were looking for the Messiah, were looking for Christ, they were looking for David. So if we look for it now. I said I want to go to Psalm 2. Dale, are you there?
Yeah.
Would you start reading, please?
Why do the nations rage and the peoples utter folly? The kings of the earth rise up, and the princes conspire together against the Lord and against his anointed. Let us break their fetters and cast their bonds from us. He who is throned in heaven laughs, the Lord derides them. Then in anger he speaks to them. He terrifies them in his wrath. I myself have set up my king on Zion, my holy mountain. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. The Lord said to me, "You are my son. This day I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for an inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. You shall rule them with an iron rod. You shall shatter them like an earthen dish. And now, O kings, give heed. Take warning, you rulers of the earth. serve the Lord with fear and rejoice before him. With trembling, pay homage to him, lest he be angry and you perish from the way. When his anger blazes suddenly, happy are all who take refuge in him.
Okay, this is a coronation psalm for a descendant of David.
Well, they sure, what tradition or what translation are you using?
The American Bible.
Different than mine, I guess I'm using
Oh. Is that significantly?
Yeah, there's a lot of, I mean, they left out things like,
okay,
with an iron rod, you shall shepherd them.
Okay, the part that I want to focus on is verses 7 and 8.
I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. The Lord said to me, you are my son, and this day I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for an inheritance, and the ends of the earth for your possession.
Notice the different points of view throughout this psalm. You have to watch that in the prophets and in the psalms. Notice, why do the nations conspire, the peoples plot in vain? First word, that's sort of a generalized statement. It's a speaker, shall we say. And that speaker continues until verse 7. Who's speaking at verse 7?
God.
God. Then who is speaking at verse 10?
The author.
The speaker, the one who started this. So notice you have the speaker, you have God, and then you have the speaker again.
Now, 7 was interesting because she said begotten.
I will tell you that
you are my son and today I'm your father.
And then is verse 7b, and through the end of verse 9, is God's words. So you see what people were looking for. I'd like you to turn down the New Testament.
I've got a question.
Sure.
So Abraham was anointed.
No.
No. And David wasn't anointed.
David was king.
Saul.
See, kings were anointed, but not Abraham. Abraham was not a prophet or a king in any technical sense.
So David was elected king or
anointed?
David was first anointed by Samuel. Remember, Samuel, this was...
Yeah, you picked him out. You got any other sons?
Yeah, that was the occasion. Don't you have another son? And he was in he was the shepherd. He was with the sheep. So he came and he was anointed. But then the people elected him. And then he was anointed again. At first, he was elected king over a breakaway kingdom, his own tribe, Judah. And then he was elected, king over all Israel. And as I recall, that's when he's re-anointed. And so, kings are anointed, priests are anointed. In fact, that's the first, Aaron the priest is the first Old Testament statement about anointing. Kings were then anointed, and in late Judaism, prophets were anointed. That's the reason the book of Hebrews says Jesus was the anointed.
Did a prophet anoint him the second time,
Samuel did not anoint him the second time. I'm not sure, Dave.
Okay.
Well, we could check that, but... I'm not sure.
So if you're anointed once, then what does the second anointment mean?
He was anointed king, king, and then over the whole of Israel. They say first he was anointed king. He was anointed, but he became king of Judah. Then when he became king of all Israel, I think that was, Mike, I need to check that before you write it.
So anyway, like, when we're baptized, we're anointed. So we're essentially a king.
And priest and prophet.
Take heed.
notice what will Paul say? When all is fulfilled, we will rule, and God will be all in all. Yeah, we're kings and priests and prophets.
We'll become one with one.
One with the one. Okay, now, would you turn chapter Matthew 4? Matthew 4. By the way, you remember Matthew 1, the genealogy, when Jesus' genealogy 2? Abraham, and what other figure is mentioned? Well, okay, before you go to chapter 4, yes, verse 1, go to chapter 1. Chapter 1 and Adele, chapter 1, verse 1, please. I'm sorry, 1 and 2.
Oh, we're back to the genealogy. A family record of Jesus Christ, son of David, son of Abraham.
Ah, notice, son of David, son of Abraham. Interesting that David is mentioned first. Go ahead.
Abraham was the father of Isaac.
Okay, now you remember that, sister. Mm-hmm. Okay, do you remember that in the second group, starting with verse 6b, and David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah? Mm-hmm. Starting with that, there is a king who is omitted. Do you know why?
Because he wasn't anointed?
Pardon?
Because he wasn't anointed.
No, he was anointed. Because
he was the king.
Did he sacrifice his son?
No, he's there. To remember that every word is a number in Hebrew and Greek.
Right.
And every number a word. And what is the number that these groups signify?
For completion, 7 times 7.
14. Read verse 17. Yeah, read verse 17.
Thus, the total number of generations is from Abraham to David, 14 generations. From David to the Babylonian captivity, 14 generations. From the Babylonian captivity to the Messiah, 14 generations.
Notice, and 14 is the word for David.
For David.
David. And of course, that's the reason the king was left out, so it'd be 14 in that group.
What king was that? Or,
pardon?
Who's this king?
I'll tell you what. Go to 1 Chronicles chapter 3, verses 10 and 11. And you can see that, because I want to move on, because we're just about through. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to at least get started on this. In chapter 2 of Matthew, there's major things have to happen, but Jesus is born in Bethlehem. Do you know why that is so important?
Yeah, that's true. Son of David.
That's where David was from. So notice, can any good thing come out of Galilee? No. The Messiah was to be born in Bethlehem. Well, he was. Okay, you see why this is. Now move to chapter 4. And Dale, I'd like you to start reading at verse 12. Chapter 4, verse 12.
When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and went down to live in Capernaum by the sea, near the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what had been said through Isaiah the prophet. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, along the sea beyond the Jordan, heathen Galilee. A people living in darkness has seen a great light. On those who inhabit a land overshadowed by death, light has arisen.
Okay, that's from Isaiah 9, a quotation. Keep reading, please.
From that time on, Jesus began to proclaim this theme: reform your life. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. As he was walking along the Sea of Galilee, he watched two brothers, Simon, now known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, casting a net into the sea. They were fishermen. He said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." They immediately abandoned their nets and became his followers.
Okay, then I also want you to read chapter 3, starting with verse 13. I meant to reverse these two, apologies.
Chapter 3, verse 13. Later, Jesus, coming from Galilee, appeared before John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John tried to refuse him with a protest. "I should be baptized by you, yet you come to me." Jesus answered, "Give in for now. We must do this if we would fulfill all of God's demands." So John gave in. After Jesus was baptized, he came directly out of the water. Suddenly the sky opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descend like a dove and hover over him. With that, a voice from the heavens said, "This is my beloved Son. My favor rests on him."
Okay. Do you know where the quotation comes from? "This is my beloved Son," on him.
The Transfiguration.
Pardon?
The Transfiguration.
That is also said at the Transfiguration. It's also said another time. It's, and I believe it's Matthew 12. Let's see. Turn to Matthew 12, would you? So at the baptism, at the Transfiguration, and here in Matthew 12. Start reading verse 15, please. 15.
Jesus was aware of this, and so he withdrew from that place. Many people followed him.
That was because the authorities were plotting to kill him. Go ahead.
Many people followed him, and he cured them all. So he sternly ordered them not to make public what he had done. This was to fulfill what had been said through Isaiah the prophet. "Here is my servant whom I have chosen, my loved one in whom I delight. I will endow him with my spirit, and he will proclaim justice to the Gentiles. He will not contend or cry out, nor will his voice be heard in the streets. The bruised reed he will not crush. The smoldering wick he will not quench until judgment is made victorious. In his name the Gentiles will find hope."
Keep reading, please.
A possessed man who was brought to him was blind and mute. He cured the man so that he could speak and see. All in the crowd were astonished. "Might this not be David's son?" they asked. When the Pharisees heard this, they charged, "This man can expel demons only with the help of Beelzebul, the prince of demons." Knowing their thoughts, he said to them, "A kingdom torn by strife is headed for its downfall. A town or household split into factions cannot last long. If Satan is expelling Satan, he must be torn by dissension. How then can his dominion last?"
Okay, now, notice that at his baptism, "This is my son, my beloved, with whom I'm well pleased." And do you know where that comes from?
Isaiah?
Comes from Isaiah 42, the same place that the material comes from in chapter 12. It also comes from Psalm 2. It's a combination of Psalm 2 and Isaiah 42. Now, whenever were those two put together before? Never. Psalm 2, remember, is what? Coronation song for King David. A descendant of David. What is that material in Isaiah? Isaiah 42. The suffering servant. Remember the suffering servant songs? There's a three of them. And they sound so like Jesus, it's hard for us to think of anything else. Why? Because Jesus used them to refer to himself.
They never gave Isaiah any flack for bringing in the Gentiles, did they?
Well,
he was way ahead of his...
Isaiah was not even regarded as a prophet.
Is that why Jesus. He got away with what he said?
Well, I'll put it like this. A lot of people got away with what they said, so it wouldn't be a matter of...
It just boggles your mind what he just said, Isaiah said. I mean, it was hundreds of years before, and he nailed it.
We're understanding it as Jesus.
Yeah.
Jews do not.
How can he?
Because it doesn't say Jesus. It doesn't say Messiah. It doesn't say king.
Somebody ought to hit him in the head with a board. it's right there.
There is nothing in there that says Jesus until you have hindsight.
Right.
Nothing. I'm serious. There is nothing there that would say Messiah.
That's a bunch of BS because the Pharisees crucified him. They had to believe, and they said, this can't be. We'll just kill him and he'll go away.
They're just fooling themselves. They didn't have to crucify him. And we can't blame them for not believing something that had no connection with the Messiah or King. Never had any connection.
Because the prophets really didn't foretell.
No.
They were looking for a military
king. That's right. They were looking for a military king. Why could David not build a house for God?
Because he
had blood on his hands. He was a warrior. What are they wanting when Jesus comes? They want to get out from under the Romans and have their own country again. They want to love blood.
Yeah, they want to fight for it.
Yes.
Well, how come we can see it and they can't? I think that the people there did. A lot of people believed them.
I'm sorry?
A lot of Jewish people believed he was the Messiah. I mean, they went against their...
They were going against their tradition.
And also, there were several messiahs before Jesus.
Oh my goodness. Just a series of people claiming to be the Messiah.
Yeah, but they didn't take any roots. But this guy was the real deal.
They took root enough that they caused the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple.
Well, what's it? Jim Neal said, if he's from God... He said, don't go after this guy. If he's from God, we'll be fighting God. The other ones went away, and if he's for real...
Yeah, that's right.
Well, he was a believer.
No. He didn't say he was a believer. He said, if this guy is from God. He didn't say he is. The big difference. So, the Jews never expected a Messiah who would accept abuse, allow himself to be killed, not to mention crucified, this is antithetical to the Jewish tradition.
There must be some evil power, like, stopping this belief then. There's got to be...
No, Dave! No!
No?
No! There is nothing that... What? Okay, let me put it like this. Why can we say we know more about who God is, what he is like, than Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Israel, Joseph, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea? Why can't we say we know God better than they did?
Because we stand on their shoulders.
No, we have Jesus showed us what God is like.
Exactly. And Jesus was brand new and radical.
What he was radical in many ways, but he wasn't radical when they came and arrested him. He was totally, I don't want to say compliant, but he was anti-violent.
I think we could say he was compliant.
Yes.
But notice, that in itself is a rebellion. It's the same kind of rebellion you had with Gandhi.
Right.
Same kind of rebellion that you had with Martin Luther King.
Right.
Submit.
A quiet rebellion.
Not a violent rebellion, in some ways, there are some people who say the most effective kind of rebellion. So, yeah, Jesus was in every way counter to everything the Jews were expecting.
You know, I just have been reading a book by Ronald Volkheiser, who talked about Jesus' passion as Jesus being passive. And I couldn't see that. I didn't see him as being passive. I just saw him as nonviolent, and I don't see that being the same.
I'm not sure I would see it the same either. To say he was passive would say he didn't do anything. If you say he was passive at the time of the arrest, yes.
But when in the temple, the money changers, he wasn't passive.
That's no, right. He wasn't.
That's right. And of course, again, where you have the temple will be cleansed, the prophets, but they never expected, they never assumed that it would be a person like Jesus. Yeah, I think it is so important that we recognize Jesus is totally different from any picture anywhere that was called Messiah. And I guess I would add this. We are supposed to be Jesus' people, right? I am crucified with Christ, Paul says. If you're crucified, you are
dead.
Nevertheless, I live.
That's Christ.
Yet not I. I'm not Paul anymore. Yet not I. But Christ lives in me. Okay? Not a warrior. Not somebody who tried to set up an earthly kingdom. Not somebody who was out to get money or power or fame. Amazing. That's Jesus. That's all God.
He was humble.
And whatever you can say about David, repentant, yes, but boy, look at all the things he did. Okay. But the Jews were looking for another David, not a Jesus. There's a lot more I could say, but really, do you have a good sense of how the New Testament views the covenant with David? Do you feel like you have that secured or not? Okay, then I will move on next week. Some of the material I will give you may be new. Dave, you asked a question last week, and I said I would find it. Jesus said to the Pharisees, "You are of your father the devil." And that's in John 8:44.
I asked that?
Yeah. He said, I made a note. Okay, shall we pray? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Gracious Father, as we look at this material and see there was a blind who recognized Jesus as the Son of David. It was a Canaanite woman who recognized Jesus was the Son of David. And yet, the wise and the prominent in this world did not. Father, we pray that we may recognize that we need the insight of the blind and the foreign so that we can see truly, see who you are, love you as you are, and live for you, having you within us. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Okay, prophets next week. By the way, if I have an idea that we're going to finish this material in most 3 weeks. If you want to do something else, let me know. If not, we're going to finish soon.